Blackstone Publishing presents Weird Women, Classic Supernatural Fiction by Groundbreaking Female Writers, 1852 to 1923, edited by Lisa Morton and Leslie S. Klinger. This book is read by Sheila Bermingham, Paul Boehmer, Gabrielle de Cuir, Justine Eyre, John Rubinstein, and Stefan Rudnicki. Introduction by Lisa Morton and Leslie S. Klinger. If our authoress can forget the gentleness of her sex, it is no reason why we should, and we shall therefore dismiss the novel without further comment. From the British Critics' 1818 review of Mary Wollstonecraft Shelley's Frankenstein. Any student of the literary history of the weird or horror story can hardly be faulted for expecting to find a genre bereft of female writers, at least in its first two centuries. A few of the authors included in this volume, Charlotte Perkins Gilman, Mary Wilkins Freeman, Clemens Hausman, were discussed in early studies like H.P. Lovecraft's Supernatural Horror in Literature, 1927. Some would be acclaimed in later, more exhaustive works like the Penguin Encyclopedia of Horror and the Supernatural, 1986, and others would find later fame, thanks largely to filmed adaptations of their work. Hermione Templeton Cavanagh, with Disney's 1959 Darby O'Gill and the Little People, and Edith Nesbit with the BBC adaptation of The Railway Children in 1968. But reprint anthologies of horror published throughout the 20th century could routinely be counted on to include few or no stories by women. Perhaps the editors of those books were concerned about the gentleness of her sex. Yet there were women writing early terror tales. In fact, there were a lot of them. During the second half of the 19th century, when printing technologies enabled the mass production of cheap newspapers and magazines that needed a steady supply of material, many of the writers supplying that work were women. The middle classes were demanding reading material, and the plethora of magazines, newspapers, and cheap books meant a robust marketplace for authors. Women had limited career opportunities, and writing was probably more appealing than some of the other avenues open to them. Though the publishing world was male-dominated, writing anonymously or using masculine-sounding names, such as M.E. Braddon, gave women a chance to break into the market. It was also still a time when writers were freer than today's writers to write work in a variety of both styles and what we now call genres. A prolific writer might pen adventure stories, romantic tales, domestic stories, mystery or detective fiction, stories of the supernatural. There were really no limits. Spiritualism, the belief that spirit communication could be conducted by a medium at a seance and could be scientifically proven, despite continued evidence to the contrary, was widely popular, and so one might expect to find that many writers of this period were producing ghost stories. But ghost stories were just one type of supernatural story produced by women writers at this time. Women were also writing stories of mummies, werewolves, mad scientists, ancient curses, and banshees. They were writing tales of cosmic horror half a century before Lovecraft ever put pen to paper, and crafting weird westerns, dark metaphorical fables, and those delicious dread-inducing gems that are simply unclassifiable. This range of subjects is, of course, not unique to women writers, but there are nonetheless certain attributes to much of their work that are distinctly feminine. Not surprisingly, many stories from the 19th and early 20th century feature women involved in traditional feminine pursuits. Family, children, and even gardening all figure prominently in their fiction. Look, for example, at the terror and pathos surrounding the children at the heart of Charlotte Perkins Gilman's The Giant Wisteria, Mary Wilkins Freeman's The Wind in the Rosebush, Elizabeth Stuart Phelps's What Was the Matter, and Olivia Howard Dunbar's The Dream Baby. In the latter story, the author addresses head-on the self-worth of childless women, even when their lives are otherwise satisfying. These early female authors often introduced social commentary into their works, especially issues of the role of women and class struggles. The suffragette movement and labor reform were important throughout this period of time. In fact, the vast majority of the women included in this book were involved in these movements, as well as socialism, and of course, spiritualism. During the 19th century, work as a domestic was one of the few options available to women who were either not born into the middle or upper classes, or were unfortunate enough to fall from them. And several of these stories, Elizabeth Gaskell's.
We hope you enjoyed this preview. To continue listening to this audiobook on Google Play Books, use the link in the video description.